The, some may dispute that it's a beautiful day out there, but it's always a beautiful day when we wake up and we can celebrate the love of God.
Yes.
And our love for one another. And so let's do that this morning as we worship together. I would remind you of the registration pads that are in every pew. Be sure to sign in and pass them down the road once you're seated. On Wednesday, I realized I haven't been collecting the registration pad from the choir. And apparently the choir was going to let me just go on and on without telling me that I wasn't collecting their registration pad. They had page after page up there. And so then I went back to the sound booth at the end and looked, and they had been keeping a chronicle forever and ever. I don't know when the last time I had grabbed it was, but let's see. They've been marking since 2/19 of 23 and recording their attendance every week. Who's here, who's not, sitting back there in the sound booth, and apparently they were going to let me go on forever and ever and ever without knowing. So I am caught up today. When I announced a week or so ago that I read these and looked at the little prayers, I thought, gosh, I gotta make sure I get them all, because otherwise I'm shorting some of the books. So I'll be more diligent to see if I can keep up with, although I do like the law from the sound booth. We're glad you're here this morning. Let's begin our worship with Holy, Holy, Holy. It's number 64 in our hymnals, right toward the beginning. Well, let's stand as we're able and sing that.
Good morning.
Oh,
the back of your hymnals. Let us unite together in this historic confession of our Christian faith.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let's take a few moments in silent prayer and meditation, then I'll lead us in prayer, and then we'll join together in the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Blessings. whether in rain or in sunshine, with clocks changing and not, Lord, may we put our faith and hope and trust in you. Forgive us, I pray, for all of our sins, for all of our failures. And thank you, dear God, for your capacity to forgive. Increase our capacity to forgive, that we might be more like you, that we might love as you love us, that we might love ourselves and others with that same everlasting love. Lord, we failed in so many situations to do as much as we can, as much as we should. May we be more sensitive to your leading and guiding this week. May we be ever ready to give an explanation, a reason for the hope that lies within us. Thank you for all that you've done and all that you'll continue to do. We pray these things in the name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus the Christ, the one who taught us to pray together, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Rest.
I invite the ushers to come forward at this time as we prepare to give them the word of God's tithes and our offerings. Go ahead and do it as a piece is because this all goes with last week's healing of a man who had been lame for 38 years. And so our pivot verse from that to this week starts at verse 16. So because Jesus was doing these things on the Sabbath, the Jews persecuted him. Jesus said to them, "My Father is always at work to this very day, and I too am working." For this reason, the Jews tried all the harder to kill him. Not only was he breaking the Sabbath, but he was even calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God. The Jews often debated, the Jewish rabbis debated whether or not God kept his own laws. Did God cease to work on the Sabbath? And around the time of the New Testament, a group of four rabbis went to Rome, and this isn't a joke. But the four rabbis went to Rome and sought to answer this question: does God keep his own laws? In other words, does God still work on the Sabbath? And they finally concluded that God lifted no burden greater than he could carry, to a height higher than he is, and that they worked it out to where God was still being God even on the Sabbath without having to come down and say whether or not God worked on the Sabbath. And so here Jesus seems to answer that question much more concisely. He continues to work, and I continue to work. And one of the parts of this that upset the Jewish leadership so much was not just that Jesus healed the man on the Sabbath, but that he encouraged the man to take up his burden and walk. It was worse to encourage someone to break the Sabbath than to break the Sabbath themselves. And so, here, at this early date in John's Gospel, the Jewish leadership is seeking to kill Jesus. In Mark's Gospel, it happens all the way in the very first chapter of Mark. The leadership is looking for an opportunity to kill Jesus. Jesus, in just going through life, in just living out his call, is upsetting the order, and people didn't like it, and they sought to kill Jesus because of it. In this 16th through 18th verses, "My Father is always at work, and I too am working." Jesus calls God his Father and equates himself with God. God is working and I'm working. We're doing it together, if you will. And that upset them. But then it goes on, Jesus gave them this answer: "I tell you the truth, the Son of God, the Son can do nothing by himself. He can only do what he sees his Father doing, because whatever the Father does, the Son also does. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all he does. Yes, to your amazement, he will show him even greater things than these. For just as the Father raises the dead and gives them life, even so the Son gives life to whom he is pleased to give it. Moreover, the Father judges no one, but has entrusted all judgment to the Son, that he may honor the Son just as they honor the Father. He who does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. So just in case he hasn't upset them enough by violating the law and seeming to equate himself with God, Jesus spells it out and says that he is equal with God. But he also says that I can't do anything by myself. And Jesus says this in other places, in other ways. It is the power of God at work in him. And I don't know how to sort all this stuff out theologically or metaphysically. It's something that I've been able to accept by faith. Maybe it's because my brain is too puny to be disturbed by some of these issues that drive people crazy. But Jesus says he does what he sees the Father doing. And the Jewish rabbis always felt that the ultimate thing that God held in reserve was the power to raise the dead. And that power belonged uniquely but unequivocally to God. It wasn't something that was dispensed to people. Now, his prophets at times raised the dead, but clearly always doing so for God, or on God's behalf, if you will. And here Jesus says that he will raise the dead, which he does in this gospel with Lazarus. And so, the ability to raise the dead is something that Jesus is saying he has as well. Well, that just, it's like piling on. You know, sometimes when you win an argument, you make the mistake of just piling on after you've won. Well, Jesus is, in his mind, I think, winning this argument, and in the eyes of the Jewish leadership, he's just making things worse and worse and worse. Because now he has claimed that he has the power to raise the dead, amplified further by saying that he's going to be the one to judge everyone. And that if they haven't honored the Son, they haven't honored the Father. So, Jesus is making a clear stand and a clear statement. These things lead to the crucifixion of Jesus. It wasn't an accident of fate. People had to make a decision. Either to believe in Jesus and to follow him, or to reject him and seek to kill him. And Jesus didn't leave any room in the middle for anybody to waffle. Either you believed in the Son, or you didn't. Either you honored the Father through the Son, or you didn't. And those were the choices that the people were given. I tell you the truth, he continues. Whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be condemned. He has crossed over from death to life. I tell you a truth. A time is coming, and now has come, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. For as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son to have life in himself, and has given him the authority to judge, because he is the Son of Man. Even here, Jesus does not call himself the Son of God, but rather the Son of Man. But again, is just heaping more and more coals on the fire of hatred against him. Or on the hearts of those who follow him, more and more hope. We do not have a faith that is pie in the sky by and by. We're not living just hoping that someday we'll go to be in God's presence. Jesus says we cross over. The time is coming and the time has come. When the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. It was just before that when he says, those who believe in him who sent me have eternal life and will not be condemned. He has crossed over from death to life. We are already living eternal life. We're still living in this body, in this world. We still get rained on. The sun still shines and the night comes, but we have crossed from death to life. And that is good news, that we don't have to just kind of, as I've often put, whistle through the cemetery of life, hoping nothing bad is going to happen. We can live with confidence that we are already living in his presence, already sharing the love of God in our daily life. And that should give us hope, and that should give us peace. We don't have to just wait and hope until we die. We can live in confidence here and now. Again, it continues. Do not be amazed at this, for a time is coming when all those who are in their graves will hear his voice and come out. Those who have done good will rise to live, and those who have done evil will rise to be condemned. By myself I can do nothing. I judge only as I hear, and my judgment is just, for I seek not to please myself, but him who sent me. We don't talk a lot about judgment, but there will come a time when we will be judged. And those who have put their faith and hope in Christ will live. And those who have done evil will rise to be condemned. Not the most comforting words that Jesus ever gave, and yet, in them lies our hope, and the reason for the hope that is in us that we should be sharing with others. I went to a district meeting on the 29th. It wasn't how I had hoped to spend February 29th. I always feel like when you get a bonus day, you ought to do something special with it when it only comes every 4 years. But they had a required preacher's meeting that day, and so I went to my required preacher's meeting. And in it, the focus of the devotional time, or the teaching time, was from I think it was 1 Peter, always be prepared to give a reason for the hope that is in you. And it was reminding us that we all need to be prepared to give a reason for the hope that is in us. So many times people think that's beating someone else over the head with the Bible. That it's, you know, telling somebody they're condemned unless they believe. I don't think that's what Christians should be doing. Christians should be sharing out of their hope, because we are not the ones who judge. We may have opinions, but we are not the judge. Jesus is the judge, not us. And no matter how firmly convinced we are that someone is in trouble unless they believe, that's not our place to think we can judge anyone. It is not our job. Our job as Christians is to give a reason for the hope that is in us. And that is something any of us can do. As long as you have that hope, why do you have it? Well, Jesus forgave me of my sins. Being able to articulate that is all others need to hear. They don't need to hear, unless you do this, that, or the other, you're in trouble, because that isn't our job. And so we're called to give a reason for the hope that is in us. And so on the 29th, I was blessed by being able to attend that meeting, even though I went with not quite fear and trepidation, but a certain level of dread that I have to drive an hour away and go to this meeting and, you know, sit on, and here you are on a bonus day. I don't know if we've got anybody born on the 29th, but I've had friends over the years who were born on the 29th, and they celebrate big because they only get one in four. Anyway, do not be amazed at this, Jesus continues. Did I just read that? I don't think I did. This is the downside of not reading it all at once. Do not be amazed at this, for a time is coming when all who are in their graves will hear the voice and come out. Okay, I'm pretty sure I read that. We're going to move on anyway. I testify by myself, my testimony is not valid. In the Jewish system of law, you could not speak for yourself. Someone else had to testify on your behalf. We all see ourselves as innocent in most situations, and our testimony isn't to be believed unless someone else can back us up. And so, therefore, there's another who testifies in my favor, and I know that his testimony about me is valid. You have sent to John, and he has testified to the truth. Not that I accept human testimony, but I mention it that you may be saved. John was a lamp that burned and gave light, and you chose for a time to enjoy that light. I have a testimony weightier than that of John. For the very work that the Father has given me to finish, and which I am doing, testifies that the Father has sent me. And the Father who sent me has himself testified concerning me. You have never heard his voice, nor seen his form, nor does his word dwell in you. For you do not believe the one he sent. You diligently study the scriptures, because you think that by them you possess eternal life. These are the scriptures that testify about me, yet you refuse to come to me and have life. This piling on, both to the good in Jesus' case and to the bad from the perspective of the Jewish leadership, Jesus is making a clear demarcation. I think sometimes we forget how much Jesus confronted the authorities of his day and challenged their beliefs in order to change them and transform them, that he might give them life if they would just listen. Jesus says that it was the testimony of John that he relies upon. Behold the Lamb of God, as we read early in this gospel. John says on consecutive days, behold the Lamb of God. And so Jesus says that John's testimony is true, and the people listen to John for a time. They bask in the light of his lamp. But the Father also testifies of him, and he says the Scriptures declare him in ways that the leadership has refused to acknowledge. And so they condemn themselves. I do not accept praise from men, verse 41. But I know you. I know that you do not have the love of God in your hearts. I have come to in my Father's name, and you do not accept me. But if someone else comes in his own name, you will accept him. How can you believe if you accept praise from one another, yet make no effort to obtain the praise that comes from the only God? But do not think I will accuse you before the Father. Your accuser is Moses, on whom your hopes are set. If you believed Moses, you would believe me, for he wrote about me. But since you do not believe what he wrote, how are you going to believe what I say? Their hope was in the book, not in the truth of those Scriptures. Jesus is revealed throughout the Old Testament, throughout the book of Moses, books of Moses, as well as the rest of the Scriptures. And Jesus challenges them to go back to the book. The problem was, they were stuck on the letter of the law and not open to his presence. How many of us, if we were there, we would all want to say we would have believed? But it was difficult. And there are still many, many, many people who struggle with believing in Jesus. There was a time when scholars believed that the pool of Bethesda was made up, that John's gospel was written so much after Jesus' ministry that you couldn't rely on any of the landmarks that John gave. But in 1888, an archaeologist discovered the pool. It's in the Muslim quarter today, and it's there very much as John described it. Archaeology has never disproven any part of Scripture. It hasn't proven all of it. It's just never been found to disprove Scripture. And so we can't put our faith in archaeology or in things or even in the book, but in the person of Jesus. We can put our faith and hope and trust and have life in his name. Life now, life eternal. Let us pray. Lord, thank you for the love with which you have loved us. Thank you, Lord, for all that you have done and all that you'll continue to do. Lord, receive us. Help us to live as those who have begun eternal life. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Before the announce the last hymn, I put in that next week's scripture will be John 6, but it won't be. I'll tell you what it is in just a minute.
All right, let's stand up and sing, "Oh, How I Love Jesus." All now and forevermore. Amen.